Hi folks, my name is Alex and welcome to another episode of Any Given Saturday. I'm delighted to be joined once again by Carter Bryant, Mr. Power Hour LSU himself.
What's going on, baby? It's good to see you. The NFL draft is here. LSU spring practice is here. I see you growing. You've had some wonderful guests on here. My buddy Blake was on here. I love it, man. I love seeing, you know, just over the overseas how much people care about American football. And like I said last time when I was on here, I care a lot about European football. I'm coming to England here in just a few weeks. Man, I freaking love, I love European football. I love soccer is what we call it. It's my second favorite sport. But college football is what I've been fortunate enough to get to do for a living now. And I've always loved the NFL. I've always loved college. I love this time of the year when the two mesh. And then more importantly, Alex, I love it when I get to see young men live out their dreams and play, you know, in this league that is extremely difficult to get in.
Sure. Yeah. Well, this episode is going to be a little bit unique in comparison to previous episodes I've done and the various guests that I've had on, in that, yes, we will be discussing the NFL draft and in particular, the former LSU Tigers that are hoping to then go and play in the NFL. Just to sort of get started, really, Carter, how would you kind of, what would your initial thoughts be kind of heading into the draft and kind of this latest batch of LSU Tigers that will be playing in the NFL?
Yeah, Alex, it's such a weird time, right? Because this is a football offseason. But what's crazy is football has kind of become a year-round sport. And ironically, it used to just be soccer was a year-round sport, right? And you would have, you know, the table, but then you would also have international play and all these different tournaments. And the NFL did something really interesting. They did a good job turning this into a year-round sport. America's biggest sport by far is American football. And it's crazy how the draft has kind of become its own separate entity. Right? It's its own thing. It's its own ecosystem. There are plenty of million-dollar businesses, and I'm not just including like ESPN, CBS, and all this stuff, just like that just focus on the draft to where when this draft is over, they're already looking at the next draft.
Sure. Yeah.
So that makes it really fascinating if you're an LSU fan, because you are a big piece of that, right? Yeah. Especially over these last couple of drafts where, ironically, the best first round picks have mostly come from LSU, right? Yeah. Justin Jefferson, Ja'Marr Chase, and Joe Burrow have all been 12 out of 10s up to this point in their career. And it's tough to have that type of success early on in your NFL career because it's so hard, Alex, to make it in this league. And then at the same time, you have college football spring practices happening. And, you know, all these new kids are coming to campus and all these college practices are going on. And guess what, Alex? We are months away from an actual snap even happening. And those are the two biggest stories in sports, right? Yeah. The NFL draft and spring football. And yes, of course, the NBA playoffs are going on. Yes, of course, MLB finally got its act together and there's wrestling and all this other stuff. But if you're in the South, particularly if you're in the Southeast, you care about the draft, you care about spring football. And the third thing you care about is college football recruiting, right? So it's such a strange time to be a big LSU football fan, especially with Brian Kelly coming in. But as far as the draft is concerned, Alex, I think it's safe to say that LSU won't have as many first round picks that they've had in the last couple of seasons. But with Derek Stingley, they hope to make it another year with another first round pick.
Sure. Yeah. And how do you think this latest set of LSU players stacks up to last year's guys that were drafted?
Yeah, I mean, it's not even close, right? So, yeah, look, Ja'Marr Chase is the best rookie wide receiver the sport has ever seen. Yeah. Whereas the year before, Justin Jefferson was the best rookie wide receiver the sport has ever seen. And that's just nuts. Like, it gives me chills to think about. Like, those two guys were so transcendent in college, and they have exceeded expectations in the NFL. And then, obviously, Joe Burrow could go down as one of the best number one overall quarterbacks. Obviously, you know, Peyton Manning and a few other names, you know, come to mind, but it does feel good as an LSU fan because the last quarterback who went number one overall in Jamarcus Russell did not turn out to be what we expected him to be. And I love Jay Russ, but you know, as far as this year, Derek Stingley's probably going to be the only first round pick. I know some people felt Damon Clark would be able to sneak in. He had the neck surgery, the disc. So he's going to slide quite a bit. And then after that, you have a weird batch of, I can see that guy making it, players in this draft. So you have Ed Ingram, an offensive guard for LSU, has started a few years. And then you have Neil Farrell, who also had an amazing LSU career. And what makes him specifically so special, Alex, is yes, those three, Clark, Farrell, and Ingram, those three guys aren't going to be first round picks, but they were named the MVP of their position groups at the Senior Bowl. Yes. So when, and you can ask a lot of people, the Senior Bowl is also known as the most intense practices you ever go to. It is rare when practices are more important than the game, but that's the case. Right. And for those that don't know, the Senior Bowl is like a senior all-star game for people trying to get into the draft. It's done the week before the Super Bowl in Mobile, Alabama. And those three guys were the three best players at their position. And it's really hard to do that because everybody is scrapping, clawing. It can get physical, it can get nasty because these young men are fighting for paychecks. I mean, it is literally a very intense week of practices. And all three of those guys did as much as they possibly could. And then of course, you know, you have a longer list of guys that you hope can get on an NFL team. It's a little bit weird, Alex, because LSU's got the number one kicker in this draft in Cade York. So where is he going to go? We'll see what happens. I think one thing that'll help Cade York next year is Evan McPherson. So the Florida kicker who went to the Bengals had one of the best rookie kicker seasons of all time. And his clutch kicking is what got the Bengals into the Super Bowl. So that's going to help out Cade York. I think there's going to be more teams that say, well, it's definitely worth a draft pick to get the absolute best kicker in the draft, especially if it's Cade York, who, you know, is a really good clutch kicker. So it's a very interesting crop of Tigers.
Yeah, no, it certainly is. And this video, for those watching, is going to work sort of in tandem with an article that I wrote for the Dropback, where I did preview and kind of predict where I believe each LSU player will be drafted. So I'll just kind of kick things off. We talked about Derek Stingley. I certainly believe he will go in the first round. I actually have him being selected and going 13th overall to the Houston Texans. Yeah. I know that some LSU fans might be a little bit surprised at that. I think he's going to have a fantastic NFL career. I mean, I have no doubt about that. I certainly think he's going to be the next kind of cornerstone of the DBU legacy.
You said you have no doubts about that?
Yeah, I don't. But the reason why I think he might just slide a little bit is just a couple of the injury. I don't really want to call them concerns because, you know, you see guys in going into the draft every year that have actual injury concerns, but maybe just the nagging injuries he's had over the last couple of years, and maybe at times sort of inconsistent play in comparison to obviously the incredible things that he did in 2019. I just have him sort of just sliding a little bit outside of the top 10, but I still think he's going to be a phenomenal talent at the next level.
Yeah, so here's what I'll say about Stang, right? So we're used to LSU defensive backs being big personalities, right? Yeah. Like Dante Jackson was just an amazing interview, and I got to interview him a few times. Patrick Peterson, I got to know at LSU a little bit. He's a big personality, and obviously Tyrann Mathieu is the biggest personality in the sport on the defensive side of the ball. Derek Stingley is not that. He's very reserved. He's very quiet to himself. And so that's not really his thing. And I think part of why he was so successful in 2019 was that locker room had so many leaders and they were built to win right now. And over these past couple of seasons, it was kind of strange, right? The team was losing and Sting at times felt a little distant. And yes, he was banged up. Now he was hurt. There's no other way around it. But, you know, I hope he doesn't go to the Houston Texans because that is a locker room that doesn't have what 2019 LSU had. Yeah. They don't have leaders. They're not ready to win now.
Yeah.
I want him going into a situation that's ready to win right now. So, you know, I want him to go as high as he possibly can, you know, because it makes more money and it's good for him. And I want him to succeed as well.
Yeah.
But I think a team that would be very good for him is a team that actually flew their head coach to see him in Baton Rouge. And that's the Los Angeles Chargers. They do need another corner. That team is loaded. That team is ready to win now. And Derek Stingley is one of those guys, whereas if he is healthy, athletically, he is ready to help a championship team now. He is a missing piece now. And the Chargers' money is allocated to a lot of different positions. They did sign J.C. Jackson, but they still need more corners. So that would be a dream scenario for me for Sting. So he doesn't have to go into a situation that is dysfunctional. Yeah. And the Texans are certainly, it looks like they're finally going in some direction. I don't know if it's the right direction, but at least it seems like they have a plan now. But Stingley is going to go in the first round. I think the bigger question, Alex, is will he be the first corner? Because it's going to be between him and Ahmad Sauce Gardner out of Cincinnati. So obviously I wish Sting the best. It's going to be interesting to see where he falls.
Yeah, no, absolutely. In my mock draft, I had Sauce going at 9.
Oh,
so okay. I believe that's to the Seahawks.
Okay. I like it, man.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. So don't get me wrong. I, you know, like any LSU player, I'd love Sting to be taken first overall, but then, you know, at the same time, sometimes it can be, you know, good for a player's career if they do slide a bit in the draft, can't it? I mean, you know, you look at, say, take someone like Micah Parsons, right? Incredible rookie career. I think going into the draft, people thought there's no way he's going to fall out of the top 5 or 6, and then went to the Cowboys at, what was it, 10, 11, around then, I believe it was.
Yeah, somewhere around there, yeah.
So, you know, yeah, it'll be certainly interesting. No doubt a first-round pick and another legacy player for DBU.
Yeah.
In terms of the second round, in my mock draft, I don't actually have any LSU players getting taken in second. We talked a little bit about Damone Clark, and I certainly believed he had a fantastic season, certainly towards the end. And he really felt like one of those guys that had really improved his draft stock, didn't he? To where, you know, he would be certain, you know, a second round pick. Could he maybe have even pushed himself into, you know, the back end of the first? But, you know, as I think you said, with his disc injury, that's probably going to push him down a bit. But my actual next LSU player getting drafted is going to be with the 71st pick, and that's Ed Ingram to the Chicago Bears. What do you think Ed Ingram can offer an NFL team, and what do you think his future looks like?
Yeah, so Ed had a slower start to the season, but he got better as the season moved on. And that's always been a thing for him. He's either hot or cold, where at a position you want just consistency, right? So that's going to be key, stringing together consistent games together. But, you know, for the most part, I think Ed can be a really good guard at the next level. And, you know, one player we didn't mention that I also think, and I'm actually saving who I think is actually going to be the best LSU player in this draft. I'll tell you in just a second.
Okay.
But I first want to talk about Cordell Flott.
Sure.
Very lanky corner, very thin corner. But it was so good to see him bounce back after a rough 2020. So yeah, I'm very interested to see what's going to happen with him as well.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I've actually got Flott going in the third round as well, but I have a guy going just before him. So 18 picks after Ingram, I've got Neil Farrell Jr. going with the 89th pick to the Buffalo Bills. He's certainly someone I'm really excited to see play in the NFL. You know, he had that great game against Alabama this year. As you said, he had a really nice LSU career. What do you think's kind of the potential impact that he could bring to an NFL team?
Yeah, Neil Farrell is very interesting. So, you know, he's a rotational defensive lineman on the 3-4 Dave Aranda defense. And then over the past couple of years, he transformed into being a dominant 4-3 player, right? Yeah. he's big, right? You know, weight around, it could be anywhere from 320 to 340. Yeah. I think one thing for him is situation. I do think situation is going to be big for him. You know, a team like the Chargers, again, once again, they actually do need another tackle. But there's a lot of different teams that could use another nose tackle for Neil, with Neil's talent. I do like the fact, though, that he has experience in a 3-4 and a 4-3, and that's something that'll help him out.
Yeah, certainly that versatility, and that's something teams are always looking for, right? So, yeah, we mentioned Flott. So I've got him with going with the 95th pick to the Cincinnati Bengals to be reunited with his former LSU teammates. As you mentioned, you know, it was great to see him have a bounce back year. And I certainly think, again, with his versatility playing inside and outside corner, would certainly be an upgrade over public enemy number one, Eli Apple, in the state of Louisiana. But yeah, you think Flott is a guy that could succeed at the next level?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is going to be weight, because, you know, he is very, very thin. And NFL receivers are different specimens. They're some of the best athletes on the planet Earth. I like that fit in Cincinnati, you know, reuniting with Joe and the whole crew there. So, yeah, and the Bengals are another team that are Super Bowl ready right now. And they could use a defensive back, and Cordell Flott would certainly fit the mold.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so right. So we've got four guys going in the top 100 picks. How would you feel if that's how it played out on across the
draft? I'd be thrilled. Yeah. I'd be thrilled with that. Once again, I do think this is very important. One thing we've learned as more draft data, you know, comes out, is there is more that we don't know than we do. And I think the second, and this is the most important thing, is where you go really, really does matter. Yeah. Like, you know, for instance, let's say Patrick Peterson, right? He would have been great no matter where he went. And he actually didn't go to, you know, a franchise that had a whole lot of success, and he still had a Hall of Fame career. So he's one of the rare, like, cases where he would have been great no matter where he went. I do think for a lot of these players, situation is going to make or break their careers. And let's say Darrell Williams, right? A backup running back, found a good spot in Kansas City. They know how to use him. He's a high football IQ player. He's used to playing a backup running back role. He was a perfect fit for what they needed out of the backfield. So situation is really important for so many of these guys.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So round four, we've talked about it a bit, but every year, great and talented players fall in the draft, whether that's due to injuries, inconsistency, character issues, whatever it might be. So I've got Damone Clark being selected in the fourth round with the 121st pick by the Kansas City Chiefs. As I mentioned, you know, I thought he had a fantastic season. He certainly felt like the kind of guy that elevated himself into the second round, maybe pushing even above that. You know, and I think there's reports, isn't there, that he's potentially going to miss most, if not all, of his rookie season recovering. Yeah. Even so, once that's sorted out, he feels like a guy that's just going to potentially be able to pop in the NFL and could have, you know, a productive career. What do you think about what he could do at the next level?
Yeah, and also he's going to be a good special teamer as well. Yeah. I mean, he's an elite athlete, speed, strength, all of that. You know, kind of like Flott, a rough 2020, and a lot of that had to do with the system that they were playing in. So once again, we're all cheering for Damone Clark, a Baton Rouge guy who actually had to, you know, overcome adversity. He was also one of those guys that during the switch from the 3-4 to the 4-3, you know, it was tough. It was tough because our defense was not well designed, and that's not any fault of their own. I hope Damone Clark gets healthy and has a long career.
Yeah. And again, we'll be another, we've talked about DBU, but I don't think the history that LSU has of putting linebackers in the NFL gets talked about enough.
I love that. Yeah. I mean, you're right on the money, and like Debo Jones, Devin White, even a backup like Kevin Minter
would be
very interesting. And I want to take it one step further here. So one thing all three of those guys have in common is they're all in the NFC South, right? So I want to share something with you, Alex, and it's a myth that the Saints don't take LSU players, right? So since 1980, the Saints actually have taken more LSU players than most teams, all right? Yeah. They've taken 7 LSU players since 1980. Now, that doesn't sound like a lot, but it really is, yeah, right? What's very interesting, and this is going to, I don't know if you knew this or not, it's going to bother you. It bothered me when I saw it. But since 1980, do you know which team has selected the most LSU players?
The Falcons.
Yes. If it doesn't make me being a Saints fan, you being a Saints fan, makes you feel a little uncomfortable, right?
Yeah, it does.
The Falcons have 12 LSU selections. Wow. It's crazy. It's crazy to think about. But really, the NFC South is where most LSU players actually go, according to just draft selection since 1980. And it really is fascinating when you think about the Falcons. The Falcons have taken the most. But a lot of them have gone there and had great careers, whether it be Debo Jones now or Todd McClure back then. It's a very fascinating thing.
Yeah. I mean, it's, yeah. I know he's been with the Buccaneers for a couple of years, but sometimes I still find it hard just watching Devin White with Devin the Bucks. White. Just obviously, you know, his LSU legacy, them playing the Saints twice a year. It's, I don't know. It's just, it's sometimes hard.
Yeah. And it's not just that, like, he knocked out Jameis Winston with that hit.
Yep.
And then it's not just him. It's Leonard Fournette, right? Finding his bearings there. And now Russell Gage, and to even add more injury to insult, Cyril Grayson, who never even played football at LSU. He just ran track at LSU. He makes it in the NFL because he is an amazing athlete, and he's catching a touchdown that would have been the game winner versus the Saints had we not come back and scored again. So it's crazy that all these great LSU players have gone to NFC South rivals to the Saints, but it is a myth that the Saints just haven't selected LSU players, but it is so much fun to look at that.
Yeah. And just talking about Grayson, because he is a really interesting story.
Yeah.
In the NFL, but sort of what was the reason as to why he didn't play football at LSU?
Honestly, don't know. Like he had a 247 profile on everything. He was a great track athlete. Right. I think it was like a 2-star football recruit.
Right.
And I don't know. I honestly don't. Yeah. I think some of it, Alex, and this is, you know, kind of crazy to think about, is there's just so many wide receivers at LSU. I'm trying to put a timeline together when he would have been out mid 2010s during the last regime. So even then, LSU had so many wide receivers that's not a position, you know, that, you know, that they're grasping for air for ever. So obviously he could have played at LSU if he's a decent NFL receiver, but yeah, it's very strange that LSU has so many good athletes that the ones that don't even play football are good in the NFL.
Moving on. So so I don't actually have an LSU player being selected in round 5, but I do have one. In round 6. So first up is Chasen Hines. I have him being taken with the 200th pick by the New England Patriots. You know, Belichick likes versatile players, and Hines has played a number of positions on the line during his time at LSU. Kind of how do you think he projects as an NFL prospect?
He struggled a lot at LSU, right? A lot. Picking up blitz assignments was always something difficult for him. His health was also something that was always difficult for him. I do like the fact that he was a good Tiger, right? Yeah. And he played through injury, and you know, you never heard anything bad, ill-willed from him. But he was just wildly inconsistent.
Yeah.
Now I'll say this: athletically, he's the best LSU lineman, and particularly the best guard in this draft. He is an amazing athlete.
Yeah.
He's got tree trunk legs. He is a vicious puller who can knock your head off. But, you know, there's more to it than just that. Sure. So I hope he turns out to be great. But it's going to take a really good offensive line coach And he had so many different, you know, he had to switch an offensive line coach towards the end of his career. It's going to take someone to refine him. And if they do, he is going to be special.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And then shortly after that, with the 207th pick, I have the Texans again selecting LSU player. And this time it's Ty Davis Price. Houston's starting running back right now is Rex Burkhead. So I certainly think that TDP could go in there, certainly with how he finished his LSU career and kind of that in massive game against Florida onwards. You know, I think TDP could you know, be another, you know, good and solid LSU running back in the NFL. What do you think about TDP and his potential future in the NFL?
So Alex, this is my guy. This is my guy. This is who I think is going to surprise a lot of people. So unlike Derek Stingley, we saw TDP play his best when his back was against the wall. And that's what it's going to be when next year with the Houston Texans that don't have a good roster. So TDP is available. He does play through a lot of injury. Yeah. He is someone that kind of workhorsed the LSU backfield towards the end of his career. So he does have a lot of tread off the tires. It does concern you. He also does have injury history, but there's a lot I like about him. The first thing is, number one, I think athletically he's a little bit better. Now, does he have, you know, Jeremy Hill, Leonard Fournette breakaway ability? No, but I do think he has a little bit more burst than people give him credit for.
Yeah,
I understand pass catching was never really his thing, but that was kind of just a microcosm of the LSU offense over the past couple of years, the ability or the inability to throw any running back out of the backfield. So I don't think that was a TDP problem. I think that was more of an LSU problem. The third thing is pass protection for him is pretty consistent. I like that about his game. So I do think TDP, who's a young 21, so we have 3 years and out. And I do like the fact that he was already a big piece, well, semi-big piece of a championship team. So to me, that puts together a perfect underrated running back prospect at the next level. I do see him as more of like a Darrell Williams type, but if you can get a Darrell Williams type in the sixth round, a backup running back of that caliber, that's huge. So yeah. I like that landing spot. I also like TDP a lot. And I do think he's going to surprise some people in the NFL.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I think there's a couple of mock drafts that have been coming out with him going, you know, maybe fourth, fifth round. So it will certainly be interesting to see where he ends up. And I think there's reports as well that he apparently looks like he's in the best shape of his life with the training he's been doing recently. So
yeah, he's got a good work ethic too. And this is something else, right? That's a little personal, but it is something that you do take into account. He just became a father, right? So that just gives you a little bit more motivation when you have kind of a physical but metaphysical kind of aspect to your game, right? Yeah. When your whole world is now centered around having a kid and you become a dad. Now, once again, I'm not a dad. Are you a dad?
I'm not.
yeah. So I can't. I'm only speaking on what you hear from people that become first-time fathers. It changes you, right? There's a different kind of switch. There's a different kind of motivation. And sometimes to make it in the NFL, something like that needs to happen, right? Something that you can't really explain just kind of happens and turns, just, you know, a switch comes off and you're like, oh, okay, if I can succeed and make it to a second contract, I got my daughter's college and, you know, her early life paid for. Yeah. And when you have something like that as well, it could be the difference in him potentially being a longtime NFL pro.
Yeah, no, for sure. Then moving into round seven. So I've got two players being selected in this round. First up, I've got Mr. Velveeta himself, Paige York, being selected by the New York Jets with the 224th pick. And then lastly, the Iron Man and record holder for the most games ever played by an LSU player, Austin Deculus, being selected with the 258th pick by the Green Bay Packers. What do you think? What do you think both of those guys could offer an NFL team?
Yeah, I'll start with Deculus. a lot of tread has been worn off that tires, yeah. Right? He's played a lot. He was a starter on the national championship team. He's the longest tenured LSU player. So it's not just the fact that he's played, you know, the most games. It's the fact that he actually did play a lot in those games. There's a huge difference. So you're obviously rooting for him. I think this last year was his best year by a wide margin, even better than 2019. So I love that. And I hope he does get drafted. And he is an LSU Tiger through and through, even though he is from Texas. He originally is from Mamou, Louisiana. And then, of course, Cade York out of Prosper, Texas. I mean, this guy is LSU's best kicker of all time. I understand, you know, there's going to be some Colt David arguments. You can make the case for a lot of players, right? Yeah. But just on pure ability, it was amazing what that guy was able to accomplish. And of course, the most legendary kick of all time, a 57-yarder from the eye of the Florida Gator. Now, you'll never there will never be a more impressive kick from an LSU player. I could say that when you're certainty in the fog where you couldn't even see the goalpost. And what makes that kick even more impressive is Evan McPherson, the kicker who got drafted by the Bengals, actually missed a kick in the exact same scenario. And it was 49 yards. And I believe York's was 57 yards. Yeah. And McPherson ended up being the clutchest rookie kicker ever in the sport. So, you know, I just showed you how big of a factor Cade York can be. So going to the Jets, obviously you want him to go to a winner, but still that it's just cool to see Cade getting his opportunity. I am a little salty. I wish he would have come back an extra year because we do have for the current team. We might be relying on a true freshman kicker next year. I would have loved to have Cade back, but I do wish him nothing but the best moving forward.
Sure. Yeah, no, absolutely. And hopefully he can get himself some more cheese sponsorship as well. there's a few guys that I haven't talked about that I just think they might potentially go undrafted. Jontre Kirkland, Andre Anthony, Cam Lewis, Darren Evans, Glenn Logan, Liam Shanahan, and Avery Atkins. Do you think any of those guys could potentially carve out a nice NFL career for themselves and make an impact?
Yeah, so in the NFL, there's not kickoff specialists because of roster limitations. If there was like just this rule where you can have a different kicker for kickoff specialists, Atkins would obviously make it because, you know, he kicks a football out of the end zone every time, which is a very valuable skill set. So that kind of sucks. Maybe he can make it as a punter, but still, Jontre Kirkland's very interesting, right? He might have to carve himself out the Russell Shepard career where you grind as a special teamer and you just keep grinding and maybe you can last in the NFL for a while. Athletically, he can obviously do it. He's played a lot of special teams at LSU. So I think those two are the most interesting out of the undrafted category.
Yeah. What about someone like Andre Anthony?
I thought what he did was really impressive with the 40-yard dash, right? Yeah. So he ran 4.6 after tearing his ACL just a few months earlier. That's just nuts. It really is nuts. Yeah. One thing about Andre Anthony, though, is that he was one of these six-year guys. So kind of like Deculus, he you know, his career lasted the full 6 years, and he's coming off an injury. So it really stinks for him. I don't know too many people that want to, you know, spend any capital on someone who is that old. Andre Anthony was one of the older players in the 2017 draft class to begin with. So, you know, I'm pretty sure he's 25 pushing on 26. Yeah. I wish him nothing but the best because it sucks that the injury happened because he started playing he was LSU's best defensive player after the first 3 weeks. And he was the leader. And I just hate that happened to him. So obviously I'm crossing my fingers and hoping for the best for him.
Yeah. I mean, that could be a guy further down the road that maybe comes back to LSU and coaches. I mean, that'd be pretty cool. He seems like he certainly loves LSU, spending 6 years there. So,
yeah, for sure.
Just before we move on to spring practice and the current team, I'd like to ask you just a question. So Kalavon Chaisson was one of my favorite LSU players, certainly on the national championship team. I just loved watching him. I just thought he was an incredible athlete. I love seeing him just kind of bend the edge and just, you know, he made some fantastic plays. and was a first round draft pick. Why do you think his production necessarily hasn't kind of matched at this stage in his NFL career yet?
Yeah, so a few things. I don't mean this in a bad way, but I was kind of iffy on Chase on going into the draft.
Right.
When he went to the Jaguars, that stinks, right? I mean, that's just a terrible franchise, Urban Meyer. So any Jaguars player gets a fresh start, actually, with a championship coach who's competent. Sure. So that's obviously going to help out. But here's where things get a little difficult, Alex, is number one, LSU, I believe since 2000, has had seven defensive linemen or edge rushers drafted in the first round, and zero have ever made the Pro Bowl. Now, some of them have had really good careers, like Marcus Spears, for instance, is one of those players. He had a really good NFL career, and now obviously he's had an even better media career. But number one, defensive line is just such a difficult position to play, or edge or whatever. The second thing is Chaisson was such a critical piece of what Dave Aranda wanted to do. Yeah. And, you know, to mix in the current team as well, Alex, that Jack linebacker role, that standing outside linebacker in a 3-4, is extremely difficult. And Chaisson was a perfect player to play that role. But sometimes pass rushing isn't the most important thing in that role. Sometimes it's just setting the edge. Sometimes it's just football IQ. Sometimes it's just running and chasing guys down to make plays. So when you actually go look at Chaisson's production, he had 6.5 sacks his final year, right? A lot of those were run and chase sacks. Now, he did have some good pass rushing moments, but in the NFL, they were drafting him to be an elite pass rusher, and that's not necessarily what he's best at. So hopefully this next year is where he takes that next step as just a pass rusher, but it's really hard. There's not many people in the NFL that can bend the edge consistently. Those Von Millers are dime a dozen, and that's why so many people spend first round picks on guys that look like Chaisson.
Yeah, sure. Well, moving on to spring practice, and the upcoming spring game this weekend, what players do you think have impressed most throughout spring?
Let's start with the biggest story for me, Alex. It's always going to be the quarterback.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, it's self-explanatory. It's going to work itself out. The biggest story, if you are an LSU fan, is Will Campbell,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yep. True freshman. He cemented himself the starting left tackle role, and it looks like there's a pretty good distance between him and whoever's next in the left tackle depth chart. And that's hard to do so quickly as a true freshman in practice. What makes it even more impressive is, for those that don't understand how that works, he's an early enrollee. So he should still be in high school. He should still, I don't know, I'll make this joke all the time, but he should be getting ready for prom at Applebee's. And instead, he is going up against grown adults, right? He's 18, going up against Ali Gay, yeah, who is getting into the prime of his athletic career. Ali Gay is probably 22, 23 years of age. That's difficult. That is mind-blowing. Could you imagine you at Alex, 18 years of age, going up against someone athletically on your same level? That's crazy. It's nuts. Imagine how big of a difference you were at 18 to 23. And he's dominating. So to me, that's the biggest story, because on this offensive line, this is one of the rare situations where you don't know any of the five starters. The fact that he quickly went in there, won that job, changed his body from, you know, at the end of his high school career to where it is now, that's where projecting things can be difficult, right? So this entire episode with all our analysis and stuff, it's fine. But sometimes there are some people who really get after it and do things away from what we see to take their bodies to the next level. We saw it last year with Mason Smith. So he went on a diet and changed up everything about his work ethic, right? And he already had a great work ethic, but he took it to a next level. Will Campbell did the same thing. He does look thicker than what he was in high school. He looks stronger. He looks smarter. He doesn't quit. So to me, there's very few things you objectively can see in spring. because there is just so much fluctuation, especially with the new coaching staff. But the fact that this young man came in and cemented himself as that guy just is really, really remarkable.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And talking about other true freshmen, it certainly seems like Quincy Wiggins is carving a name out for himself already and is looking good.
Yeah, it's been kind of rough for him from my vantage point. It's hard. It kind of goes back to what we were saying about Chase on a minute ago, where the defensive line can be really difficult whenever you make that transition. Not many people are Mason Smith, and it makes what Mason Smith did, you know, that much more impressive last year, even though he got hurt at the end. It's hard because what makes defensive line tough for a younger prospect is in high school, the best thing for you as a defensive lineman is just run into the backfield if you're more athletic than the offensive lineman. And that's what Quincy Wiggins was able to do every snap. So if you put on his high school tape, it's just like crazy. It's like, wow, he's just running back there and just getting everybody. In college, you can't do that, right? Yeah. You got to play with technique. You got to bring your hands. It's a transition that is a lot harder for players if, you know, you're just accustomed to running into the backfield and eating everyone's soul. So that's what's going to be difficult for him. I've seen him struggle some in practice. It's going to come down to can he take that coaching with the new defensive line coach, Jamar Kane? Because Quincy was really close to LSU's old defensive line coach. So, you know, once again, when you have a late coaching switch and you still go to LSU, it does make it tough. But if he takes the coaching, he'll definitely get to play a lot in year one.
Yeah. Yeah. And how concerned are you about the tight end position and the depth there, particularly with Jack Besh now transitioning to receiver?
Yeah, I think Jack might still play some hybrid tight end, but it doesn't look like he's made that transition. Obviously, you know, we did a film study on this and on my channel. Nick Storrs is a tight end from the 2020 team. He didn't play in 2021. He's back. So he kind of becomes that third tight end. Cole Taylor and Jack Mashburn are probably still ahead of him on the depth chart. But Nick has got some real blocking chops. He can move people. And what's interesting about it is LSU has a history, or Notre Dame has a history of running 12 personnel, two tight end formations, right? So if you bring another tight end in, that makes Brian Kelly feel more comfortable when he wants to run 12, when Dimbrock wants to run 12 personnel. So you take a wide receiver out, you bring a tight end in. So I think that's going to be key for them moving forward. I think they're going to still try and get a tight end somewhere from the portal. Yeah. Where that's going to be is still up in the air. But, you know, for me, that's going to be a big key.
Yeah. And what are your thoughts on Corey Kiner transferring to Cincinnati? I believe it was announced last night. And what it means for the LSU running backs room.
It's a win-win. You know, he gets to go back home. He had a little homesickness. He's been dealing with an injury. And that obviously stinks. And that's where we are right now. Like the Cincinnati Bearcats is the number two school for him. They're obviously a really successful program, and the depth chart is probably a little bit more clear because the LSU running back room is so deep.
Sure. And last question, what are you looking to see from the spring game this weekend, and in particular kind of any goals you think that they'll want to achieve from this?
Yeah. So for me, I am looking right now. Okay, so this is official. It's just broke. So the spring game, obviously, big thing. The biggest thing about the spring game is that it's not going to be LSU versus LSU. It's going to be offense versus defense. So normally you split the teams up, you split the rosters up, and one team's purple and one team's white. This year, it's just going to be offense and defense, okay? Sure. The second thing, though, is you don't want any injuries. The third thing is the spring game is actually something that you can actually – you know, draw quarterback performances from instead of just some practice clips. Yeah. And I know I do on my channel some really deep practice clip breakdowns. It can get very technical, but you know, in the spring game, you're going to have a wider angle and you're going to be able to see everything happening. And to me, it's what happens after the spring game. What is LSU going to do with their roster with three transfer portal slots remaining? But now, Alex, it's two because the official announcement, Seven Banks is coming to LSU, the defensive back from Ohio State. So that just broke, and that's obviously pretty big for LSU's defensive back room, which to me, honestly, Alex, you know, I feel a little bit better about offensive line than what I did a few weeks ago. Same thing for tight end. Defensive back is the room that I'm most concerned about at this moment in time. And obviously adding Seven Banks, if he's able to stay healthy, would go a long way for that room.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Do you think there's a chance he'll play this weekend, or he won't be here in time?
Oh, no, he's not. He's not going to be here in time.
Okay.
So I was looking, I'm not a big like Intel scoop guy. I don't let that be a part of my channel because breaking news does just fluctuate so much. You never know when, no one saw the Courier Kiner thing just happening yesterday, right? Yeah. Sometimes a player just does that. They just go and say, hey, I'm leaving. And then it's just how it works. The Seven Banks thing, LSU knew they were getting him for a while. This wasn't something that just happened. So like a week and a half ago, I had it on pretty good authority that he was coming. So that's obviously, you know, really good for LSU's defensive back room. LSU really did put a press on him to get him here. And it goes a long way. So we'll see. Hopefully, you know, they have two transfer portal slots remaining. We'll see what they do with it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And then just one last thing. Which players are you most looking forward to seeing this weekend? Maybe outside of the big names or the guys that have been talked about a lot, Will Campbell's and the quarterbacks. Are there any other guys that kind of you think maybe going under the radar that you're looking forward to actually seeing, put the pads on and see what they can do?
Yeah, obviously the four quarterbacks is what we're going to look at the most, right? Yeah. Garrett Nussmeier, Walker Howard, Jaden, and Miles. Yeah. Outside of that, you know, obviously the wide receiver room, we have a good idea who those guys are, but there's just so many of those guys. So does Chris Hilton play? That's someone I'm very interested in.
Yeah,
me too. And Kyron Lacy, who's had a few deep touchdowns, because, you know, ahead of them, Kayshawn, who's not playing at all during the spring, he's the best player on the team. But you have Jack, you have Malik, you have BTJ, you still have Dre ahead of them. So that's going to be, you know, very interesting. Trey Bradford has moved up the depth chart during the spring, someone I'm very interested in seeing. Yeah. And then to, you know, go one step further on the defensive side of the football, Jacobian Guillory's had a really good camp. He's obviously a mammoth in the middle. And that linebacker room, very interesting. A lot of new faces. You know, Mike Jones, you feel pretty good about starting. But Wes Weeks and Colby Fields, two transfer portal players, two very young players, are going to be some fun players to keep an eye out for as well.
Yeah, most certainly. Well, thank you so much for your time today, Carter. Is there anything else you'd like to add just about the YouTube channel or anything else in particular?
Power Hour LSU, just come hang out. I'll say this. If you don't love LSU football, if it's not one of the top five things in your life, don't come. Don't come watch, right? I know normally at the end when you're trying to sell a channel, you're always like, everybody come subscribe and ring the bell and do all that. No, if you're not a diehard LSU football fan, don't come. It's not for you. It's not for you. There are other places where you can get, you know, stuff, college football stuff. But if you're a diehard LSU football fan and you love the intricacies of football and you love Death Valley on a Saturday night and you love ice cold beer and crawfish and all that stuff, that's what we do, man. It's all I care about in the grand scheme of things. I care about a few other things, chicken wing, crawfish, and LSU football. That's it. So, yeah. And I also care about Liverpool. We're coming for all four of the titles. We're going to win the FA Cup. We're going to win the Champions League. We're going to win the FA Cup, Champions League. We're going to win the EPL.
Yeah.
What's the fourth one? There's the fourth one that we're in.
Oh, the
come on.
Oh, the other. Oh, the Caribou Cup. Did you mention
that? Oh yeah, no, we've already won the Caribou Cup.
All right. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, we've already won it. One out of penalties because their goalie shanked it. We're coming for all four, baby. Mo Salah, Sadio Mane, Trent Alexander-Arnold, all led by Jurgen Klopp. Oh, yeah, we got Andy Robertson. We got Hendo. We got Allison in goal. Ooh, let's go. Let's go. I can keep going. We got Joel Matip. How could I forget Virgil van Dijk, the best center back of all freaking time. And if people don't know who Virgil is, some people thought I just yelled out an epithet. No, that's his actual last name, Virgil Van Dyke. He's, you know it, Alex. You know, if Virgil Van Dyke is one of the few soccer players where if you put him on if you put him at defensive end, he would dominate. He's that level of an athlete. He is a mammoth. He is a freak of nature. He is Virgil freaking Van Dyke. Freaking love that guy. But no, Alex, thank you so much. I know you're a football channel, but I had to just get my...
No, that's absolutely fine. I think it's brilliant. I think Carter's going to go crazy when he comes and sees Liverpool in a few weeks' time.
Going to England, I'm coming to say hi to you, and we'll talk soon, my man. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you, and have a great day.
Boom.